So welcome to the Dual Anonymous Peer Review Town Hall for Planetary and Exoplanets Research Programs. My name is Delia Santiago Matariz. I'm the lead for the Dual Anonymous Peer Review process under the Planetary Science Division out of NASA headquarters. And we'll have program officers from the programs that will be doing Dual Anonymous Peer Review, and they'll be introducing themselves shortly. First of all, please submit any questions you have during this presentation via the link here. It is also posted in the chat. You can upvote questions already posted as well. In addition to that, you can ask questions in the chat of the presentation. Due to the large number of people, we're going to field questions in that manner, and you might get some of the answers back to you from the other program officers in the chat, but we'll also be answering some of the questions at the end of this town hall. And we will also have, we already have some pre-prepared answers for the questions that were posted earlier. So this slide's gonna be a quick overview of Dual Anonymous Peer Review, which we fondly call DAPR. And I'll be going more into depth into all of these points later on. But overall, we have this great website on Dual Anonymous Peer Review. Also note that these slides will be posted there later on, so you can access all of this information and a lot more at this website. The goal of Dual Anonymous Review is to reduce implicit or unconscious bias in the evaluation of the intrinsic scientific merit of proposals. And the way we do this is that, in addition to the proposers being unaware of the review panel member identities, the reviewers themselves are not told the identities of the proposers until after the evaluation of intrinsic and scientific merit. So the process for proposers, and again, I'll go into this more in depth later, is that proposals are written to exclude any personally or organizationally identifying information in the scientific portion of the proposal. And they must upload a separate expertise and resources not anonymized document, which contains all of the personally or organizationally identifying information. For the reviewers, this means that they evaluate the intrinsic scientific merit of anonymized proposals without knowing the proposing team, who they are. And after the scientific evaluation is finalized for proposals, the panelists will review the expertise and resources anonymized documents to assess whether the team has the qualifications and capabilities necessary to do the proposed work. So we'll be going over what programs are going to be converting to DAPR, Dual Anonymous Peer Review. What exactly is Dual Anonymous Peer Review, and why is it important? How to make your proposal compliant, and how it's going to be evaluated. So which programs are converting? So first of all, we've already done a number under ROSES 20. These were all inspired by the work of the Hubble Space Telescope reviews by the Space Telescope Science Institute starting in 2018. But under ROSES 20, SMD did a pilot with one program from each of the divisions. So the Astrophysics Data Analysis Program, Earth Science, US Participating Investigator Program, Habitable Worlds from Planetary Science, and the Heliophysics Guest Investigator Program. So Habitable Worlds is still under review, but the other three have all been completed, and I'll be showing some information on that. In addition to that, the Astrophysics Guest Observer, Guest Investigator Programs are permanently converting to Dual Anonymous Peer Review. And a note on the programs I just mentioned that were piloted under ROSES 20, all of those will be continuing under DAPR under ROSES 21. HabWorlds is not being called under ROSES 21, but that the other ones are going to be continuing under DAPR. For 2021, of interest are the columns on the right, Planetary Science and Cross-Divisional. We have our DAPs here, and the Exoplanet Research Program, which is largely managed out of Planetary Science. So to go more in depth about the Planetary Science Division programs, first of all, under ROSES 20, we have Habitable Worlds, which is managed by Lindsay Hayes and Becky McCulley-Wrench. And I believe Lindsay is here, if you want to say hello. She might not be able to say hello right now, but Lindsay is here, and they've been working on this review. And the proposals have been submitted, the review process is underway. Just a few proposals were returned without review because of egregious rule violations. But most other non-compliances were allowed through. PIs were given a warning letter, but the proposals are still being reviewed. And we expected this under the first year. So I'll go more into depth about some of those violations, non-compliances later on, once you have a more clear idea of what one should be doing. But really quickly, the most common issues are failure to follow the reference numbering scheme that you're supposed to follow, and then just slips, basically. So someplace it will say, you know, co-I, and then give a name, and then later it refers to them anonymously. So just small little slips like that. Under ROSES 21, we have all of the data analysis programs, as well as the cross-divisional exoplanet research program. So here are the list of program officers, and we can start from the left if folks want to introduce themselves, starting with Cassini DAP.
This is Henrik Swoop on the Cassini DAP, CDAP, and also on New Frontiers DAP. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Doris Tao, and I'm the program scientist for Discovery DAP.
Hi, I'm Shoshana Wida. I'm the lead for the Lunar Discovery, Lunar Data Analysis Program. Glad to see so many people online today.
And I don't know if Mitch Schulte or Adrian Brown are here, but they lead the Mars Data Analysis Program together. And I believe our XRP lead is here.
Hi, everybody. I'm Megan. I'm the lead from PSD for XRP. It's good to see everybody.
Thank you. So now we'll talk about some of the motivation. In summary, this is also called double blind. We tend to say dual anonymous now. Dual anonymous review is to address issues related to implicit bias. So a classic tale is that in the 1970s, the top five orchestras in the US had fewer than 5% women. When blind auditions were instated, that went into the 30s, the 30%. And another example is with behavioral ecology, they switched to double-blind review, which resulted in a significant increase in the number of female first authored publications. So first, it's difficult to completely interrupt implicit bias through training. It's also referred to as unconscious bias because we aren't always aware of our biases. So structural changes are needed, which is why we're doing this. We want to thank the Hubble Space Telescope team for pioneering dual anonymous peer review. And here's some data from them. So this was before they switched to dual anonymous peer review, you can see the proposal acceptance rates between male and female PIs. And so this is the percent of male PIs that were accepted and the percent of female PIs that were accepted for a given cycle. And you can see that there is a difference. And theoretically, there's no reason they shouldn't be accepted at the same rate. So when DAPR, or their dual anonymous peer review, was introduced, this difference decreased. It didn't completely go away. And you can see for cycle 26 that females were slightly overrepresented, and then the next 2 years, they were slightly underrepresented compared to the percent acceptance rate of men, of males, but this difference decreased, and that's the overall point. And I want to point to some preliminary data we have from the Astrophysics Data Analysis Program. So this is a slightly different chart. This is the percent proposals with inferred female PIs, and the total pool is the leftmost group, and then the on the right are the top two and top three proposals from every group. And blue is non-DAPR, and you would theoretically, there's no reason that the, you know, between year to year that these wouldn't just go straight across, but you can see that the percent proposals with female, inferred female PIs were underrepresented in the top two and three proposals in each panel before DAPR, but with DAPR, it reached more parity with the percent that submitted. So gender is just the tip of the iceberg. Another thing we're always looking at is success rate by institution type. These are the success rates for the ROSAS programs in the SMD pilot under ROSAS 20. And you can see that government contractors and NASA centers are selected, have their proposals selected at a higher rate than non-R1, R2 academic institutions or minority serving institutions. And there are a lot of factors at play. We don't claim that bias is everything, but the idea is to level the playing field for everyone. It's not a silver bullet. It doesn't solve everything, but it's one tool to help level the playing field with everyone. So what exactly is it? Again, the proposers are unaware of the identity of the members on the review panel, but the reviewers do not know who the identities of the proposing team during the scientific evaluation of the proposals. And the intent is to eliminate the team as a topic of discussion, not to make it impossible to guess who might be on that team. We know that people have very specialized fields, and there are, you know, you might feel like you can narrow it down, but the idea is not that you can't guess at all, but the idea is we're not talking about this. And we want to create a change in tenor of the discussions away from the individuals on the proposing team and toward the proposed science. So it's not completely blind process. We have proposers submit the anonymized proposal, but also a not anonymized expertise and resources document. And the first step is the merit of the proposal is assessed, and separately, the qualifications of the team are assessed. So the qualifications, track record, and access to unique facilities is indeed part of the evaluation. It's just separated out. Feedback from Hubble panelists is that proposal discussions were characterized as more collegial and efficient. Focus was squarely on the science rather than the scientists. There was a noticeable shift in the depth of discussions as well. It was clear that the reviewers had read the proposals very diligently and that without the distraction of names or institutions, there was no recourse but to focus on the proposed science. Discussions at both the panel level and the TAC, that's the Time Allocation Committee level, focus predominantly on whether the science was novel, impactful, and feasible with HST, and not on whether the proposers had the expertise to carry out the proposals. Several TAC members noted that they felt the discussions at both the panel and the TAC level seemed more collegial and less emotionally charged than previous TACs, perhaps because either positive or negative feelings about the people involved with the proposal were largely removed. So how do you make your proposal compliant? We're giving you lots of information, but first of all, step one is not anonymized. It's submitted per normal requirements. And step two is anonymized per the guidance that follows. So first, the NSPIRES program page. Each element will have a document entitled Guidelines for Anonymous Proposals, and it has a lot of detailed information about submitting the anonymous proposals. And a quick start tutorial and FAQs are at the website listed here, which is the same as listed above. So first of all, you need to exclude all names and affiliations of the proposing team, including anything in figures or references to personal websites. Do not claim ownership of past work. So instead of saying my previously funded work or our analysis shown in whatever, you would say previous work shows or previous analyses in this reference. You would just have it be, you would have no ownership of it. And references are cited in the passive third term. So you can see the yellow, this prior analysis brackets one indicates that. And that just kind of draws attention away from, you know, who's frequently cited. You can still say we when you talk about, you know, the work you're going to do. You can say we propose to do something or we will do something like that. You just can't say it in terms of ownership of the past things. And you'll include the separate, not anonymized, expertises and research document. So how do you publish, how do you reference unpublished work, proprietary results? You might need to do this occasionally, or maybe not in public software. Things that haven't been presented in public, but they're not citable. That could imply the investigators, but we want you to kind of, again, refer to in without attribution or ownership. So you can use language such as obtained in private communication or from private consultation, which people can do anyway, but you will do that in reference to yourself as well. And just again, recall the goal of dual anonymous is to shift the tenor of the discussion, not to make it impossible to guess the team members. Regarding institutional access to unique resources, another common issue is that you might have unique access to certain facilities to do the work. And you can still talk about this in the STM, the scientific and technical management section of the proposal. You just should do it in a way that does not identify people. So you can say the team has access to this ultra high resolution IRMS, which will enable the required measurements. And in this kind of situation, we would recommend you can support that in your expertise and resources document. And this is an example of anonymization. And I'm actually going to just go to the next slide where we highlight. So the yellow goes to yellow. So instead of saying in Rogers 2014, we concluded, say prior work concluded. If our model from this is correct, you say if the model from this is correct. We will compare with our first epoch. You'd say a first epoch was obtained in 2007. Those are examples of how to translate that text. And a really big thing is that many people obviously resubmit proposals. This is where it gets a little trickier. We really ask you to really check things when you're resubmitting a proposal or reusing text from something else. Just double check that you're not claiming ownership of past work. Do not include the names of personnel associated with the proposal or their organizational affiliations. Write the references in the format as indicated. Use third-person neutral wording. And then again, you can go to this website for information. But how is the capability of the team to execute the investigation account? I know there's kind of a concern that somebody's gonna write a proposal, but they don't actually know how to do that. And is NASA gonna be funding people that are not qualified? But we're gonna make sure that they are evaluated for that. So we have the expertises and resources document. So it's a separate document you upload. And it is distributed to panelists for a subset of proposals, typically the top third. It depends on how the program decides to do that. But it's more than we would presumably, slightly more than we would potentially select. And it will have the following elements. So you have the list of the team members and their organization and their roles, a brief description of their expertise and what they're bringing to that, a discussion of the contributions of each member, the team member will make to the specific investigation, a discussion of the specific resources required to perform the investigation, so access to laboratory equipment, specific samples or sites, etc., a summary of work effort to include in the anonymized table of work effort. So you'll have a anonymized and not anonymized portion for that. And that's outlined more in the guidelines document. Biographical sketches as required, statements of current and pending support as required. This is all in the expertise and resource document. And any letters of resource support. So if there's some facility that you need to have access to or letters to the PDS, things like that, that all goes in the expertise and resources document. And how will your proposal be reviewed? So we have the two parts. We have the science review and the expertise assessment. The anonymized scientific review will take place and everything is finalized. The evaluations are written, they're signed off, they are done before the expertise and resource document reveal occurs. And then once that occurs, it'll occur for that subset of proposals and panelists will assess the team and resource capability to execute the proposed investigation. And this is how what the panelists are instructed to do. They're instructed to consider proposals solely based on the merit of what's been proposed for the first part. And they're instructed to not spend any time trying to identify the PR of the team. And even if they have an idea, they're supposed to discuss the science and not the people. And there are NASA appointed levelers present to ensure that the integrity of this process. And they're going to be present in each panel. And they're also instructed to make sure that their language is important discussing the proposal. So they should use, neutral pronouns, such as what they propose, the team has evaluated data, et cetera. And the NASA appointed levelers, which in some cases are program officers, but it's always somebody that's, job is to be listening to the conversation. They're gonna be there to support all of this. They are there to ensure that everyone's focusing on scientific merit. They're not necessarily listening for issues related to science, just more that they're focused on the discussion itself. And if the discussion ever becomes inappropriate and trying to guess anything about the proposers, the leveler can refocus the discussion and they have the authority to just stop the discussion of the proposal. Then the discussion of the resources, of the expertise and resources document occurs. So again, the scientific evaluation is completed. And then these documents are distributed to the panelists for the subset and they assess the team capability using this scale. So proposers are either uniquely qualified, qualified, or not qualified to do the proposed work. We set the expectation that the vast majority of proposals are going to be qualified. And there actually is a requirement that if the reviewers find that the team is uniquely qualified or not qualified, they actually have to write something about it and justify that reason, because we do expect the vast majority of teams to just be qualified. And uniquely qualified does have both of them have a very high bar. So for example, to be uniquely qualified, you have to be exceptionally capable of doing the proposed work and also have singular access to resources to complete the work. And being not qualified means you have severe deficiencies in the necessary expertise and resources to execute the proposed investigation. And when this is distributed, we instruct panelists to base their assessment based on what's written in the text and not say things such as, oh, so-and-so is clearly qualified. So we understand that DAPR is a major shift in evaluating proposals and preparing them, and there might be some slips in writing these proposals. We do reserve the right to return without review if there are particularly egregious violations and noncompliance in terms of identifying the proposing team. So we also know that some work is so specialized that even if you're trying to anonymize a proposal, the identification of the PI and the team members can be discernible. But as long as you follow these guidelines, we're not going to return your proposal without review. That's not our goal at all. So quick review of DAPR experiences to date. We've only had 3 egregious violations on the anonymization guidelines, which resulted in proposals being returned without review, and that's out of hundreds. Here are some common pitfalls that we see maybe 10 to 15% of the proposals. Claiming ownership of past work, so our previous analysis, PI has an established record. Including metadata, this is kind of a tricky one, that might reveal the name of the PI. So, you know, bookmarks, for example, might have some PDF bookmarks that might have the name of the PI. When people recycle proposals prepared prior to dual anonymous peer review, and they kind of, they kind of skip a sentence or something and they don't anonymize everything. Providing the names of the investigators on the contents page, we've had, some like wonderfully, beautifully anonymized proposals, but then they just accidentally left in a title page or contents that had their name like right at the front. So that's something to be aware of and double check. Providing the origin of travel for professional conferences, that's something to leave out in the, in the anonymized portion of your proposal. You can just say that, you know, you're traveling. You don't need to say that in the anonymized portion, you don't need to say your starting location, for example. Mentioning the institution name and the budget narrative. So this is something to double check with your budget people. I know that a lot of times the people who prepare the budgets are working, you know, they might not always be aware of the latest guidelines here, and their default template has the institution. So that's something to check. And including PI or COI's name in budget tables. It's another thing where we'll see like a perfectly anonymized proposal and then the budget table just like names the PI because again, it was prepared and you know, a different person prepared that. And then from panelists, the reviewer surveys thus far have indicated that the discussions were more focused on science content than on non-DAPR reviews. And there was overwhelming support to continue DAPR in future reviews. And those are results from NASA SMD so far. So I'm going to answer some submitted questions. These were submitted as of about midday yesterday. Why did the Planetary Science Division not go with open peer review? So the goal of DAPR is to reduce implicit bias, which involves removing the identity of the proposer from consideration when evaluating the intrinsic merit of a proposal. So open peer review might address other concerns or goals. I know it's been credited with more, collegial interactions and such, but it's not directly designed to address issues of implicit bias. And we're basing this off of HST's process, which suggested that removing the identification of the proposer that inferred female PIs were selected at a rate more on par with their submission rates than in previous years. So this process has been shown to address some issues of implicit bias. How does the dual anonymous process work with continuation proposals? So this is some language from the guidebook for proposers, which, the kind of key point is at the end, it says, therefore NASA will consider all proposals received in response to a notice of opportunity for funding, notice of funding opportunity as new proposals and will review them impartially. So proposals submitted to under a DAPR program are, like other programs, reviewed as new proposals and reviews as such. So they should not refer to previous funded work in the anonymized portion of the proposal. You can refer to that work in your ENR document. How do we refer to relevant previous work without outing ourselves? So I think I just addressed most of this in the presentation, but to just emphasize, you are free to refer to the work itself. You just cannot claim ownership of it, and you should discuss it without attribution. For unpublished works, we recommend saying previous work instead of our previous work or obtained in private communications. And then there were a couple of questions. So how do we describe the use of analytical labs to be sure the reviewers don't find out where the work would be done? And the second question, I will confess, I was not completely sure of the intent of it, but it was that dual anonymous makes sense when everyone was proposing the same use the same equipment. How can it work in an open proposal call? If I'm not addressing that here, please feel free to use the chat, because I just wasn't quite sure what the nugget was of that. But I believe the questions are about how do you talk about specialized equipment? And you can talk about these aspects, you just can't discuss them with attribution towards your group. You can refer to having access to specialized equipment, facilities, and if that's required, the panel is going to flag that, and then when it comes time to go for the ENR review, the expertise and research review, then they can check for that. So, the panel might say, wow, this is really, they're going to have access to this. Like, not many people have access to that. And that's not going to be a weakness or a strength. They're just going to flag it. And then in the ENR, it'll be apparent if the group actually does have access. And so they'll perform that full analysis using the three-point scale. And again, just remember that the goal is not to make it impossible to guess the identities of the investigators, but to shift the focus away from the individuals and toward the proposed science. And then there were kind of a group of questions that kind of asked the same thing, but the idea was that a scientist's track record is an excellent indicator of future research output. Shouldn't this be part of the evaluation? So the proposer should be able to make their case through the description of their proposed work that they have the necessary skills to achieve research success. And the track records are addressed in the ENR document, and they're going to be voted on. And we're not trying to make it impossible to guess who it is. We're trying to shift the focus of the conversation. And this is a follow-up is, how do we evaluate a proposal without knowing their track history? And there were several questions all related to this. In the past, there were programs that funded purely on track record. That's not something we're currently doing. And we evaluate the proposals new every time. And I would also like to note that to date, no highly rated proposals evaluated under DAPR have been submitted by a team where they were not deemed at minimum qualified. And this is out of over 500 proposals submitted to NASA MSMD. How do we handle proprietary restricted access resources? The example given in the guideline was not convincing. So we just ask you to use the guideline given. We'll flag it and we'll verify it later. And I keep saying the same thing. You know, we're just trying to shift the conversation toward science, not people. And if you follow the DAPR guidelines, we're not going to return it without review. And if we are seeking to fund or use a specific observatory where the set of PIs are known, and sorry, I cannot completely see this. Can we no longer reference that observatory? You can still reference it in the STM. You just can't write it in a way that you're identifying the team member. So you can say the team has access to telescope time on the WMK observatory, which will enable follow-up of the galaxies in the sample. And in this situation, we encourage you to follow up and say how you have access in the expertise and resources document. And yes, that's amazing. Oops. So some final remarks here. Oh, actually, this is a good place to bring up any other questions. I want to list all the program officers here. You can ask any of them for questions about this. And if it's very DAPR specific, you can always reach out to me, but I encourage you to reach out to your program lead as well.
This is Henry Throop. I'm gonna read a couple of the questions, Dali, that have come up in the on the webpage that have been voted up. The first one here is for technology development. Proposals often build on previous work, and with a small field, proposal teams are identifiable. How does that work?
So are any of these, I did not think any of these were technology development programs. I mean, I know they're data analysis programs. So that is an interesting point. We don't have any technology development explicitly in any of these programs. So I definitely see that point, but we haven't also extended DAPR to those programs at this point in time. So that will be something, you know, we'll need to decide if that's the right match for that.
Thank you. Next question is, can you address how the institutional and management sections of the proposals should be adapted to DAPR?
That was this last slide that I thought was missing, and I think I just clicked over it. It went really quickly because I actually remember spending time on this question, and then I was all of a sudden at the final remarks page. Okay, I have a slide for that. So this is a couple of things. A lot of this is from the guidelines, but I'm just breaking it out. So the STM portion itself is written anonymized. The summary of work effort is included in an anonymized fashion. You can say COI 1, COI 2 in the main document. And then in an non-anonymized fashion in the ENR document. So you'll have the table twice, once anonymized, another time not anonymized. And then as usual, Rose's proposals include a redacted budget. The redacted budget that is provided to the panel doesn't have salary, fringe, or overhead, but it doesn't have, you know, names of people, etc. But you should have a bare narrative that discusses financial support for the COIs. You can have it anonymized. So it's the same thing where you've always had a redacted budget. It's just anonymized, and then in the unredacted budget, you can use names and all of that. And the facilities and equipment section is not included in the main proposal document. It's a shortened version of this information, including letters of resource support, are in the expertise and resources not anonymized document. So I think that addresses most of the components of that question.
Thank you. Next question is, Similar to the question addressed about labs and access, how do we anonymize a proposal that uses a code that is not open access? And I can imagine, for instance, a proprietary code might be linked to one institution or might even have the institution's name in that code. How do we address that?
You can say that you have access to it. I mean, you can consider while an institution might have access, like anybody can share code, right? Like you could have a collaborator who shares that code who's not that institution, for example. So the point is that you can refer to it. You just can't say. You can't say that you can just say that you have access to it. It's the same, basically the same as facilities. You just say that you have access to it. And again, I mean, yes, does that possibly give a clue? But that's, you know, it's within the rules. And, you know, the point is you're saying, you know, you don't say that you created it, but you can say that you have access to it.
On the review, does DAPR in any way affect how conflicts of interest are identified and managed?
So to some extent, I need to double check. So we are having to, the onus is more on the program officers to manage these. But we have changed some of our internal processes. And I think that's all I can say about that at the moment.
Will the proposal be sanctioned in any way or penalized in any way if proposals accidentally reveals too much information about their team members and work they have previously done?
So the first year we're trying to be more forgiving. We understand that slips may occur and we've been able to draw a clear line so far of egregious versus not. It's been pretty straightforward where, you know, it was clear that somebody didn't do it at all, anonymous a proposal at all, versus like, oh, they had like two slips or something like that. So if we, in general, find that there's been a good faith effort, you might get a warning this year, but it could still be reviewed. But if it's egregious, it will be pulled, but has not happened extensively this year.
We had a couple of questions about formatting references. Has NASA provided any templates for formatting references in the correct way with numbers rather than the PI's names?
No, so there's in the guidelines document, basically it's numbered brackets and then you number it. So it'll just be like a numbered list and you refer to it in the numbers in the proposal. So.
And presumably there are standard LaTeX templates out there other templates that one could use to format the references that way. Question about the review panel for the flow of the review panel. Does the evaluation of expertise extend the time that the panel will meet for? Does it take longer to discuss this than it does normally?
It's pretty brief, actually. It's not a substantial, it adds minimal time to the panel, I would say, like maybe, yeah, this is a very rough, you know, it's going to depend on each group, but maybe an hour if that, and, but there are other parts of it that are, you know, you're actually spending less time discussing some of those things during the actual discussion. So it kind of evens out in some ways.
We have a question about external reviewers. Will external mm-hmm. reviewers also see only the science portion of the proposal, or will they see the non-anonymized section as well?
They will just see the anonymized version.
Let's see, for facilities, what if you have sort of private 100% ownership of the facility, and identifying that facility would definitely identify you?
I mean, it would, so in general, I mean, you would just say that you have access to it. You would just say we have access to it. You don't need to say we have access to this and only the people that own the lab have access to it. So you would just refer to having access to it. And if somebody happens to know that it's, you know, something that only those people have access to, then That's what it is. But the point is to just say you have access to it.
And one more here. May a PI volunteer to be identified as author of the proposal?
I don't understand. What's the question?
I think that the question refers to whether someone may opt out of the dual anonymous system and identify themselves by name in the proposal.
I mean, from what I'm hearing, that would be outside the guidelines. So I'm not quite sure if I'm understanding the question.
I think that's what the question is. Yes.
Okay. And just a note too on the very specialized equipment issue, and I know this comes up a lot, is that, you know, we don't know, this could be a lab of five people, and there could be postdocs or people who graduated from them, and we don't know who is who, and that is still, you know, anonymized. And anecdotal information is that a lot of times people guess and they're wrong, and they think they know who it is, and they don't always. So again, and the point isn't to try and guess and see if you're right or wrong. The point is to not be talking about it as much.
Let me pass it over to Doris now, in case she has questions to pass on.
Most of the questions that were asked have already been responded to, but there's a question here about, can we have any anonymized description of expertise in science, in the STM? E.g., the team has decades of experience in counting craters along with recently developed experience in numerical modeling.
That's something that just by default belongs in the expertise and research document. And it's, it just, that's where it belongs. It's not that it's, that's where it goes. Like by structure, that it would go in the ENR section.
There's another question about the conflict of interest, which you've addressed. And also I want to let you guys know that Dan Evans also addressed that question. So if the answers are not full for you, feel free to pose it again. There's a question about the program officers. When we are preparing selection document, will we be doing this blind as well? With anonymized proposals?
So we know the identities, and that helps us manage the process.
There was a lot of conversation, and I think that already has been addressed about what do we do if we have access to facilities or past papers, publications. So I think, unless I see something new, that's about it for the questions on the chat.
Let me add one question here.
Okay.
Can I add one question here? Is there any change to the page limits? And what can you say about the page limits of the expertise document?
There is no page limit to the main part of the document. You kind of end up having a little bonus space because you're excluding some of the stuff that is normally in that portion. And the ENR document does, I haven't looked at the call in a long time because we're like way off cycle, but it should not have any page limit. And also Dan Evans is, who I believe joined us during this, he is the lead for SMD doing the dual anonymous peer review. And so thanks to Dan for pioneering this. And if you had anything to say, you're welcome to chime in and say hello to everyone.
No, you're handling it beautifully already, Delia. No need for me to chime in. And there is no limit to the ENR document, but typically speaking, a few pages, maybe up to five pages is about right, including, you know, bio sketches and stuff like that. But for the written material, you know, lists of expertise and so forth, that's typically about a page or two.
We also had a question about the slides for this town hall. Would those be posted and available?
Yes, they will be on the dual anonymous page. And actually, if somebody is able to post that page in the comments, that would be great so that people know where to find that. It's been referenced numerous times, but obviously, if you don't have the slides, you can't access the page. So, through it.
All right, Delia, if you have time, I have a couple more questions here.
Okay, great.
All right, so a question about the citations. If the citations are fully listed at the end, then what is the point of changing the in-text to number
four? So the idea is to just draw attention away from that. And it's kind of a compromise, right? Because if we say, if we had put the references, you know, if the references were in the redacted portion, people are going to be like, oh, they're citing these crazy references that are completely invalid. So we might have a way for people to properly cite things, but it's not up front and center. And we, you know, we do rely on the honor system of the reviewers to not make it, you know, like a hunt to figure out, you know, who's cited a lot. But
another question asking if there are any statistics on the proportion of proposals with excellent to very good science ratings, but very low qualifications rating.
So we've only done the reveal for the top rated proposal. So like if something was rated fair or poor, we weren't doing the reveal. And then of those that made it to the expertise and resource reveal, none in SMD have been deemed not qualified. And so it's just those three categories, not qualified, qualified, uniquely qualified. And I don't know how many have been deemed uniquely qualified, but my understanding is the vast majority have been just qualified.
All right. I have one more question. For a follow-on proposal, do you still need a section on accomplishments from the previous award? How can that be anonymized, or should this be left out?
So I think that was hinted at in the continuation question. So that should be in the expertise and resources. And whether or not it's required at all, you can talk to the specific program lead for that. So I would talk to the specific DAP person to see if that needs to be included at all. But if you are including it, it would be in the expertise and resource section. And it would just be, it's considered part of your expertise.
Okay. And there's a question about, let's see, would the review process differentiate between the new proposals and the follow-up proposals?
Yeah, so you don't refer to your previous work. It should just be standalone. So you're not making any reference to previously funded work, including, you know, your predecessor proposal. I think that's answering it, right?
Okay. One more I have, I think this is the last one I have here, and it's quoting the questions on the Q&A page. As an important sub-questions on referring to previous work, how do we talk about preliminary work for this proposal? Could we say we have done the analysis shown in figure one, since this is still anonymous, but demonstrates its capabilities? Which I haven't heard discussed, basically.
Yeah, if it's not published anywhere, then yeah. I mean, if you've published it in LPSC recently, then that's kind of you're making that connection. But if it hasn't been published anywhere, and that can be attributed to you, I see no reason why you wouldn't be able to refer to your preliminary results.
Thank you, Delia. I think that's all I see in the chat. If I missed your questions, please type it again.
Do any of the program officers have anything they want to chime in? Anything?
And then well, I just have to say a lot of people are putting thank you notes. I hope you'll get a chance to read them after this.
Well, thank you everyone for coming here, and there are a lot of resources available, and feel free to reach out about any questions. I know that this is a big change, but we're excited to work with everybody on this, and obviously thanks to my colleagues for being here and supporting this event, and thanks to the community. So have a great day, everyone. And I don't know, Shoshana, if we stopped recording, but